Amen. We have been on this series we are calling Don't Just Survive, Thrive, No Matter Who You Work For. We get this series from the book of Daniel, and today's message is how to fireproof your faith. How to fireproof your faith. This is the fifth sermon on this series. This is the fifth sermon on this series. We will extend it one more Sunday to next Sunday. And so we will be concluding this series. We may not be able to do study the entire book of Daniel, but in our own time you can continue to study it. But we would be bringing the last message next Sunday. And so I would like us to read from the book of Daniel, chapter 3. Daniel, chapter 3, and I will read from verse 1 up to verse 6. Daniel, chapter 3, reading from verse 1. King Nebuchadnezzar made a golden statue 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide, and set it up on the plains of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then he sent messages to the high officers, officials, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the provincial officials to come to the dedication of the statue he had set up. So all these officials came and stood before the statue King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then Aaron shouted out, "People of all races and nations and languages, listen to the king's command. When you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the harp, the pipes, and other musical instruments, bow to the ground to worship King Nebuchadnezzar's golden statue. Anyone who refuses to obey will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace." May the Lord bless his word. And so today, as I already announced, the heading of our message is how to fireproof your faith. How to make sure the fire does not consume you when you go through the fire. How to respond when you are under pressure. Regardless of where you work or what you do, when you go under pressure, when you are put under pressure, how do you respond? And so today, basically, I want us to look at two things. Number one, I would like us to answer this question. What should I do when I am in the fire? What should I do, or what should you do when you go through some kind of fire in your life? And then I want us to come back and look at what happens when I trust God in the fire. What happens? How does God respond when I trust him when I am going through the fire? So we are going to look at four things that you need to do and four things God promises to do when we trust him. These three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they did four things right when they were threatened by the fire. The king Nebuchadnezzar had set up this statue, and he had commanded that everyone should bow to this statue. And the consequences were, if you don't, you will be thrown into the fiery furnace. So these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that we find in the book of Daniel chapter 3, they did four things right. And I pray and I believe that if we do the same four things, we will survive in our fire. Number one, I want us to read together. Number one, 1, 2, 3. Don't worry about defending yourself. Don't worry about defending yourself. Don't try to defend yourself. When you go to work and the heat is on, the pressure is mounting, and many times it's because of your stand, your moral stand. You want to do the right thing, but the pressure mounts. People stand up against you because of your moral stand. Sometimes you work in a place as a lady who believes the Lord, who loves the Lord, and you realize that in your organization, in that system, you can never be promoted unless you give some favors. And sometimes some men who are the leaders in your organization, they will not give you an opportunity to go up unless you give them some sexual favors and things like that. What do you do as a woman of God? And the same applies. It could be your boss is a woman and is expecting the same from you. What do you do as a child of God? And that's why I'm saying, number one, don't worry about defending yourself. Don't worry, don't try to defend yourself. Just quietly trust God and he will take care of your attackers. Hallelujah. Trust God and he will take care of it. Sometimes we as human beings, when we go through the fire in our place of work, we want to come with a horse, the fire horse. We want to come with some water to try and put up the fire ourselves. I want to say to us this morning, if you forget everything I've said so far, God is a better firefighter than yourself. I repeat, our God, the God you trust in, is a better firefighter than yourself. He has got a better fire engine than yourself. So when you are in the fire, remember that God is a better firefighter than you are. And he got a whole much lot of water because he created all the waters you can see in the entire world, in the entire universe. So don't worry about defending yourself. When you look at verse 16 of Daniel chapter 3, the Bible says, then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, O Nebuchadnezzar, we don't need to defend ourselves in this matter. They said, O Nebuchadnezzar, we don't need to defend ourselves on this matter. Romans chapter 12 and verse 19, it says, dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. And so I add, don't worry about your attackers. God will take care of them. Number two, remember that God has the power to save you. When you are going through some kind of fire in your life, don't worry about defending yourself. Number two, remember that God has the power to save you. It doesn't matter what kind of mess you are in, what kind of a crisis you are in, what kind of difficulty you are facing, what kind of fire you are trying to put off in your own life, just remember this. God has the power to save you. When you look at verse 17, the first part of it, it says, if we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we worship is able to save us. Is that the understanding you have about your God? I realize sometimes, brethren, the way we handle ourselves out there in the marketplace and even everywhere else is like we do not really know that our God is powerful. But these three young men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they said, if you throw us into the furnace, the God we worship is able to save us. I have come here this morning to announce to someone, regardless of what you are going through, I have come to remind you that our God is well able to save you from that fire. That is quite a statement. We know our God is able. He got the power to save us. When you look at Psalm 20 and verse 6, it is not on the overhead here. Psalm 20 and verse 6 says, now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven with the saving strength of his right hand. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven with the saving strength of his right hand. That is the God we serve. Number three, it is not enough just to know. Number three, believe that God will save you. Believe that God will save you. When you are in a problem, when you are in a crisis, when you feel like the whole world is falling apart, I want you not just to know that God is able to save you, but believe that he will actually save you. When you look at the second part of that verse, Daniel chapter 3 and verse 17, the second part of it says, and he will save us from your power, O King. They were so confident. They were so sure that God will save them. If you are going through some kind of fire right now, you just don't need just to know the promises of God. By the way, did you know that in the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, they are about 7,000 promises. 7,000, not 700. 7,000 promises. And one of them, it says that I will never leave you nor forsake you. Right now, you may be going through the fire and you feel like you are alone. One of the promises that God has given us in his word is that I will never leave you nor forsake you. You know, many of us, we are believers, and yet we actually don't know that God has given us this many promises in his word. It's just like taking a flight. You are flying from Nairobi to Amsterdam or to another destination like New York. And the flight from Nairobi to Amsterdam, it will be anywhere between 7 and 8 hours. Some people don't know that when you bought the ticket, you also paid for the food that is offered there. And sometimes you pretend that you are fasting, so they come to serve you and say, anything I can give you? Anything I can serve you, sir? And say, no, I'm okay. Not that you are okay, but you are ignorant. You actually don't know that when you purchase your ticket, you also paid for the meals. You know, the other day I was with my friend in the SGR from Nairobi to Mombasa. And it was first class. So we were in the first class, and in the last few weeks, months, they have introduced the first class. As soon as you sit, they give you a cup of tea. They give you a snack. So the first time I actually thought that they want me to pay for it. I said, these guys, they want to make more money. But later on, I realized that it is paid for. When you paid $3,000 in your first class ticket, you also paid for that snack. So we were in the SGR from Nairobi to Mombasa, and the people, you know, those two people who are serving there, they pass by and say, coffee or tea? I said, tea. And I was given the tea. And my friend was seated on the other side of the aisle. I was busy reading. I did not realize he did not take the tea. And he said, I am okay. Only later on to realize he was not taking tea, and I knew he had not taken tea. So I said, why didn't you take the tea? And then he said, you know, it is paid for. So later on when those ladies passed by, they gave him the tea. The point I'm making is this. Many of us, we are suffering in the fire by ourselves, not because God is not with us, because we are ignorant of the fact that God is with us. Can somebody say amen? And so, it is not enough to know that God will save you. You must believe that He will actually save you. Hallelujah. The Bible says here, in the book of Isaiah 43 and verse 3 up to verse 2 and 3, it says, when you go through the deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord, your God. Hallelujah. I know God can save me. But it's not enough just to know that He will save me. I must believe that He will save me. Look at your neighbor and ask him, what fire are you going through? Are you going through any fire? Are you going through any difficult? Maybe a financial difficult? Are you going through some challenges at your place of work? I am here to remind you that God will save you. So don't just know that He will save you. Believe that He will actually save you. He will come through for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Elder. And then the Bible says here, I want you to note, it says, when you go through the deep waters, when you go through the rivers of difficulty, when you walk through the fire It does not say if, it says when. So look at your neighbor and tell them, believe it or not, you will go through the fire. Some of you are thinking, you know, Pastor, give me a better prophecy than that. Prophesy that the fire shall not come near my house. But I tell you what, that prophecy will not come to pass because you will. The word of God says, when you, not in case. It's not saying, in case you go through the fire. It's saying, when. Right now you may not be going through the fire. It's a matter of time, you will. The Bible does not say that you go past the fire or around the fire. It says, when you go through the fire, that fire will not consume you. Hallelujah. And so I am expecting that God will come through for me. So it is not enough just to remember that God will save me. I must believe that He will save me. Number four, you announce your loyalty to God. Announce your loyalty to God no matter what. If you are having to face your boss, or you are having to confront someone at your place of work or anywhere else, maybe your boss wants you to do something that you know it is not right. He wants you to bribe so that you can get that business. And as a believer, you know you cannot do that. When you face your boss on such an issue, you need, first of all, to announce your loyalty to God, no matter what. Whether you lose the job or not, announce your loyalty to God. Verse 18 says, but even if God does not save us, He says, we know He will. But I want you to know, King Nebuchadnezzar, that even if God does not save us, we will never serve your God or worship the golden statue you have set up. That is pretty courageous. They are announcing their loyalty to God no matter what. We know God can save us. We believe He will save us. But if He does not, we are still not going to bow to your image. When God delivers you, sometimes He will deliver you. Sometimes you pray that God will deliver you. But I want you to know that there are many ways He will deliver you. There are many ways He will deliver you when you are in the fire. Number one, sometimes God will save us from the crisis. When you pray, God answers. But He may not answer the way you expected. Hey, are you still with me? Can I see your hand in the church here? You are with me this morning. When you pray, God answers. God always answers our prayer. But the answer may not come the way you expect. So sometimes God will save you from the crisis. I love it when God delivers me from the crisis. Hallelujah. When I go to prayer, when I kneel down and ask God, request God for something, sometimes when I am going through a crisis, maybe it is my own making. Sometimes I made a bad decision and I am facing the consequences of that decision I made. And sometimes I go to God and say, God, please deliver me. Oh God, cover me. I don't know how many of you have ever prayed a prayer like that. Cover me, oh God. I know I blew it. What I said, I shouldn't have done it. But Lord, cover me. And I'm just saying, oh God, cover me. Cover me, Lord, cover me. Let people not know the decision, that damn decision I made. I'm the only one who have ever prayed a prayer like that. You know, sometimes God will answer and cover you. But it was last Sunday, I think I said, aren't you glad that God does not always answer your prayer? Seriously, I am happy that God does not always answer the prayer I pray the way, He does not answer the way I want. Because if God answered all your prayers, some of you will be dead. Anybody who has ever been fed up with life, they say, God, I am fed up. I just want to die. Can you imagine if God answered that prayer? You will be dead. Any of you have gone through a crisis in your marriage, and you say, God, I wish I would just close my eyes, and when I open my eyes, I find I am not married. Can you imagine if you close your eyes like now, you are not married? The impact of that situation, I mean, all the investment you have made with your wife or your husband, gone. All the children you have raised, can you imagine? Close my eyes right now. And I realize I don't have a son called David who is just right here under the camera. I can't imagine that. So I thank God He does not answer all my prayers. But I get excited when He does. Some things, like right now there is a prayer I'm praying and I am expecting God to come through for me. And I will be so excited, just like many of you will be so excited when God comes through and says yes. But it is not always that God says yes. Sometimes God will save us through the crisis, not around the crisis. He does not let you avoid the crisis, avoid the fire. You got to go through the fire. Sometimes God saves us through the crisis, through the fire. We walk through the fiery furnace. He does not take it away. He does not take the problem away, but He takes you through the problem. And He gives you the strength to handle that crisis. That is why we read earlier in Isaiah 43 and verse 2 and 3, it says, when you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you, for I am the Lord, your God. So sometimes God will save you through the crisis. Number three, sometimes God will save us by the crisis. Sometimes God will save us from the crisis. Sometimes He will save us through the crisis. And sometimes, actually many times, He will save us by the crisis. What do I mean? Sometimes, the problem you are going through is not the problem. So, the problem saves you from the real problem. Have you heard stories of people who went to hospital, they had an headache? They had a headache, bounding headache, and they go to hospital and say, doctor, give me something. This headache is killing me. This headache is killing me, doctor. Give me something. And the doctor, before he will give you strong painkiller, he says, let's do some tests. Let's run some tests. And then when he runs some tests, they discover you are having a tumor in your stomach. Sometimes you wonder, what has the headache has to do with a tumor? And then they will probably remove the tumor. If it is cancerous, take you through radiotherapy or chemotherapy, and then they save your life. So the headache was not the problem. The headache saved him or saved that person's life. If it was there was no headache, the doctors would never have discovered that he had a tumor. And that tumor could have killed the person. So look at your neighbor and tell them that God can save you by the crisis. How many of you have ever had fever? Anybody who has ever had fever? I'll be surprised if some of you have never. You know, what do you do when you have a fever? You start shivering. And then, if you are like me, I ask my wife, give me more covers, more blankets. We don't have blankets, so more bed covers. So the more it gives me more bed covers, the more I keep shivering. And my wife will say, we must go to hospital. After we are prayed, we must go to hospital. And say, no, just cover me, I will be okay. Then she will insist, no, you must go to hospital. And so many times we go to hospital and then they discover the many fevers I've ever had in my life, it has a lot to do with the bacteria infection. And so, instead of giving me more blankets in the hospital, they remove the blankets. Then I say, what's wrong with you? Don't you know that I am having a fever? Because they know the fever is not the problem. The fever is an indication that I have a problem. Are you with me? So the fever is not the problem. The fever will save me from something more worse. If you are sick and you never have a fever, whatever sickness you have may never be identified and be treated. And so, sometimes God saves us by the crisis. Hallelujah. A brother said he's so glad that the girlfriend, his first girlfriend, dumped him. Then I say, why are you so glad that your girlfriend dumped you? And yet, when he fell in love with this first girlfriend, he knew that is the perfect will of God. And he was told by other mature believers that this relationship will not get you anywhere. We know this person. And they said, you are jealous. You don't understand. We are in love. And then eventually, this lady dumped him. Of course, he went through denial. He went through some pain. And eventually, he let it go. And then he fell in love again and married his wife. And he was saying, I am so glad that I was dumped. Because if he was never dumped, he would have missed the leap of his life. Are you hearing me this morning? Young people, you are going through some difficult relationships. Maybe you are here right now and you are dumped. Somebody promised he was going to marry you and then he dumped you. I want to announce to you this morning, God is saving you by the crisis. You know, some of us, you are sacked in your place of work. You work in a place and you get sacked. You serve in that place for so long, and then you get sacked or you get retrenched. And some of us, we cry for so long. These people, they are not fair. I have served them for so many years. I have given my entire life to this company. And what do they give in return? They fire me. And some of us, what you do, you build a monument. 5 years after you've been sacked, you say, you know, that company is a bad company. They sacked me. You know, I would have been so far if they didn't. Sometimes there are two types of people. One category, after they have been sacked, they reinvent themselves. Actually, they discover the potential they have to start their own company. And they move on. But the other category, they build a monument and they keep crying there for so long. Look at your neighbor and ask them, which one are you? Are you here and you have been mourning over something? Mourning over a relationship? Mourning over somebody who left you? If it was the will of God for your life, he would not have left. Now he has left. And even some of them have gone ahead and got and married. And you are still mourning about it. I am here to announce to you, God is saving you by the crisis. Can somebody say amen? The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6 up to verse 7, this is what it says. It may be necessary for you to be sad for a while because of the many trials you suffer. Their purpose is to prove that your faith is genuine. Even gold, which can be destroyed, is tested by fire. So your faith, which is much more precious than gold, must also be tested so that it may endure. Then you will receive praise and glory and honor. So, why does God allow us to go through the fire? Why does God allow you and I to go through some crises in your life or in our lives? Why does God allow us to go through pain? It is because God is more interested in building our character than comfort. I repeat, God is more interested in your character than he is interested in your comfort. And somebody has said that if life had no problems, you would not have learned anything. If life had no difficulties, no challenges, no fires, no furnaces, you would never have learned anything. Probably you know people who are headed in the exact opposite way of God, and then they lost money, they became bankrupt, some of them went through divorce, lost some loved ones, and God got their attention. And so the problem actually saved them for eternity. So let us see what the king does, and then we also look at what God does. When you look at Daniel chapter 3, verse 20, all the way to verse 23, it says, then the king ordered some of his strongest soldiers to bind their hands, this is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and their feet with ropes, and threw them into the blazing furnace. So they tied them up, and they threw them into the furnace, fully clothed. But because the king in his anger had demanded such a hot fire, the flames the flames leaped out and killed the soldiers as they threw the three men in. But securely tied up, they fell down into the blazing flames of the furnace. So, what happens when I trust God in the furnace? What happens when you and I trust God in the furnace? The story shows us four benefits when you trust God. When you trust God, when you have faith in the midst of the furnace. Number one, God will walk through the fire with you. God will walk through the fire with you. That is a big relief. You won't be alone. God's presence will be with you. Over and over in the Bible, God has promised and said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You are not alone. Can somebody say amen? You are not alone. Please look at your neighbor and tell them, regardless of what you are going through, you are not alone. You are not alone. God is with you. He has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You may not feel him. You may not see him. But you can trust. You can lie on his promise. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So, number one, God will walk through the fire with you. When you look at verse 24 and 25, it says, But suddenly, Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in amazement and asked his advisors, didn't we tie up three men and throw them into the furnace? Yes, we did, they said. Well, look now, he shouted. You can see four men now, unbound, walking around freely in the fire, unharmed. And the fourth man looks like a son of the gods. When you look at this phrase, the son of the gods, it's just like saying, he looks like an angel. He looks like he's not human. I wish Nebuchadnezzar knew he was not a son of the gods. He was the son of God. Praise the name of the Lord. He was not the son of the gods, the son of one of the gods. He was the son of God, Jesus Christ. He was walking through the fire right there with them. That is exciting. That when I go through the fire, when I go through pressure at work, Jesus is with me. Hallelujah. This is what he said in the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verse 20. It says, Jesus said, I will always be with you to the very end of the age. I will always be with you. Always, not sometimes. Not when I like you. He says, I will always be with you. Again, the book of Isaiah, this verse again, it says, when you go through the deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. When you go through the rivers of difficult, you don't have to drown. When you walk through the fires of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord. I hope you notice again, it says, when, not if. When you go through the fire, when you go through the storms, when you go through the floods, he has guaranteed you that he will never leave you nor forsake you. Number two, he will burn off everything that ties me down. I like this. He will burn everything that ties me down. God will burn off everything tying me down. You notice in the fire, they did not get burned. They didn't even smell. They didn't have any smell of fire. The only thing that God burned off was the man made robes that had kept them tied. The Bible says that those robes that tied them down, God burned. The question is, what is tying you down? What is tying you down? What is holding you back? What is limiting you from what God desired you to become? God is saying he wants all those burned up. So God may take you through the fire, but you are going to come out on the other side untouched and burnt. But the things which will be burned off, they are only the robes, the things which are limiting you from becoming that which God intended you to become. I speak to you this morning in the name of the Lord. May everything that has been holding you back be burned off. May everything that has been limiting your progress be burned off in the name of Jesus Christ. And then the Bible says that they did not even have a smell of smoke. Somebody has said this: pain never leaves you where it found you. I found this interesting. Pain never leaves you where it found you. This is what it means. Sometimes you go through pain in your life. Actually, let me tell you that where you are right now, much of what has contributed to what you are right now are the difficulties you have gone through. They are the pains you have gone through. If pain found you here, it does not drop you there. Pain becomes your stepping stone to your destiny. Many times, pain in your life makes you to realize your potential. So pain never leaves you where it found you. You cannot go through the fire and remain the same. Can I see your hand? Is anybody listening to me this morning? You can never go through the fire and remain the same. People who have gone through fire in their lives, they have discovered themselves. They have discovered what material they are made of. You can never know the potential you have. You can never know the material, the ability you are made of until you go through the fire. The Bible says in Isaiah 48 and verse 10. Can we all read this together? 1, 2, 3, let's read. I have refined you, but not in the way silver is refined. Rather, I have refined you in the furnace of what? In the furnace of suffering. God is refining you right now. If you are going through some difficulties in your marriage, in your life, at your place of work, with children, God is refining you, because God is more interested in you building character than he's interested in building comfort. There was a story I had many years ago of a man, they call him a silversmith man. The man that processes silver. And silver, just like gold, it has to pass through a strong fire so that the fire can be able to remove all the impurities. When the fire burns off all the impurities, then pure gold or silver remains. And so one lady decided to go to the silversmith man to be able to see the process of refining silver. And so she went in there, and the man had something like a long tongs. He would be able to hold the piece of silver and put it in the fire. And as much as this man was talking to this lady all the time, but the man's eyes never left the silver. He was always, his eyes were focused on the silver. And this lady at some point asked the man, the silversmith man, tell me, how would you know when the silver is ready? How would you know that it is now ready, you don't have to keep it in the fire? And the silversmith man said, that is very simple. It is simple. When I see my reflection, I know it is ready. Are you with me? When I see my reflection on the silver, I know it is ready. That is why I said, God is more interested in building your character than your comfort. When he sees his reflection, then he knows you are ready. Jesus wants us to be more like him. And it is not the good times that will be able to display who we really are. Any of us, if you are seated here and somebody comes and looks at us, all of us will say, wow, these are wonderful Christians, men and women of character, until the fire comes, until you go through a crisis. Any of you who comes to this church, sometimes we say, hallelujah, Pastor. Praise the Lord. Oh, I thank God. You look so spiritual. Some of you, when we meet, it's like you just came from heaven last night and then you came to church. But wait until when there is no money in your home, when you have no money, when you are having financial challenges. Wait until when there are some misunderstandings. The words that come out of your mouth. And you wonder, is this the same angel who was in church last Sunday? When there are no challenges when we are in worship. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. When the worship team is leading us in worship, we are all ready. We are heaven material. We know if Jesus came right now, we all go. But wait until when there are challenges. The fire actually is the one that brings the really us. Is anybody hearing me? When you go through the furnace, that is when the true you comes out. And I am here to announce to every one of you, don't waste your time praying that God will remove the fire from your life. If you are going to become that which God intended you to become, the fire is a must. At some point in your life, you will have to go through the fire. Forget about all these prophets who are telling you, send some 310 shillings and all your problems will be gone. They are all liars. Listen to the true prophets. You will go through the fire. And the fire will refine you. Hallelujah. And when the fire refines you, it will transform you. Jesus' reflection will be seen in you. Number three, God will make sure that you come out unharmed. He will make sure that when you come out, you are not hurt. Even King Nebuchadnezzar thought, before he even thought about this dumb decision or idea of building this statue, God already knew the outcome, that they are not going to be burned. When you look at verse 26, it says, and 27, then Nebuchadnezzar came as close as he could to the door of the flaming furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out. Come out at once. So the three men stepped out of the fire, and then the prince, the princes, the prefects, governors, and advisors crowded around them and saw that the fire had not touched them. Not an hair on their head was singed, and their clothing was not scorched. They did not even smell of smoke. Whoo, hallelujah! There was no smell of smoke. Number four, it will bring unbelievers to God. It will become a testimony. It will become a witness. It will bring unbelievers to God. How you handle pain and how much you trust God through the pain. How you respond when you are under pressure. It will either be a testimony to bring people to Christ or push people away from Christ. The Bible says in verse 28, then the king said, praise to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel to rescue his servants. They trusted in him. They devoured my command and were willing to die rather than suffer or worship any god except their own God. I want you to notice this. Nebuchadnezzar himself said, they trusted in God. That is what I want to be known. What do you want to be known for? King Nebuchadnezzar said, they trusted God. They trusted him. That is the highest compliment. They trusted him. And they came out unharmed. The question is, what are you willing to die for? What are you willing to die for? As I bring this to a close, please look at your neighbor and ask him, have you figured out exactly what it is that you are willing to die for? You know, some of us have nothing that we are ready to die for. Maybe you will die for money. If somebody stole your money, you will die trying to get that money back. Really, if you don't know what you are willing to die for, then you don't know. You are not ready to live. You are not ready to live until you know what you are willing to die for. They were willing to die for their faith. You are not ready to live. You are just existing until you know what it is that is worthy dying for. And some of the greatest things that happen in our lives are going to come when we go through the fire. Because new life springs out of fire. Here is what happened in the story in verse 29 and verse 30. It says, therefore, I make a decree. If anyone says anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they will be put to death and their houses will be destroyed. There is no other God who can save anyone like this. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to even higher position in the province of Babylon. I want to say to you, my friends, that 2,500 years later, that statement is still true. There is no any other God except our true God. Who are you looking to secure you, rescue you from your fire? Who are you looking to deliver you from that crisis? Or are you just thinking that you can save yourself from that crisis? The Bible says, then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego even to higher positions in the province. As I have said before, and I say again, For every success, there is a test. He tests you with distress before he can trust you with success. For every success, there is a test. He tests you with distress before he trusts you with success. I want you to know, brethren, the way we handle our fire, the way we handle our challenges, will either bring people to Christ or push them away from Christ. There is a story I shared here a while ago. There was a young man who was a bank robber. He used to rob the bank. He used to forcefully go to the bank and steal money from the bank. And he had a neighbor who was a believer. And this bank robber, with all his rasta on his head, he has been watching this neighbor who was a believer. Watched how he handled himself. Watched how he handled crisis. How he handles challenges. And he looked like he was happy even when he had no money. And this bank robber wondered, what makes this man happy? What makes this man behave and respond the way he responds when he is in the crisis? And yes, he has no money. And one day this bank robber decided that he was going to follow this man, this neighbor, to church to find out exactly what makes this man different. He said, I am fed up. I have tried to find happiness robbing the bank, and it is not helping. It's not working. So one day he decided, I'm going to follow this man to church to get what the man has. So he followed this neighbor to church. He sat in the church, and there was a visiting preacher. There was a visiting preacher who was preaching that Sunday. And the preacher preached, and at the end he made an altar call. Is there anybody who wants to receive Jesus Christ into his heart? Anybody here in this building who wants Jesus to forgive his sins? I would like you to lift up your hand. There was only one hand of this bank robber. With his rastas, he raised his hand up and he came to the altar and he was led in the sinner's prayer to receive Jesus Christ into his heart. And the resident pastor knew that this man was a bank robber. Everybody knew he was no joke. And so after the service, after the prayer at the altar, he was led to the counseling room to be given more instructions. So when he was taken there, the resident pastor, told the visiting preacher, you know what? The man who came forward, you can't believe it. That is a bank robber. I can't imagine, a bank robber. I've never seen a bank robber come to the front and receive Jesus Christ. And the visiting pastor said, wow, you mean I preached so well until the bank robber decided to give his life to Christ? And so he decided to go, maybe he strengthened up his jacket, and he went to the counseling room and he asked him, hey, I want to ask you, what part of my message really touched you until you decided to receive Jesus Christ? Maybe the preacher had 3 points or 4 points like mine. Which point really touched you? And the surprise of the visiting preacher, the bank robber, now ex-bank robber, said none. None of your sermon touched me. And then the preacher said, then why did you come forward to receive Christ? He said, I came forward because I have been watching my neighbor. I have been watching my neighbor, and I realized that my neighbor has something I don't have. So I followed him to church to also get what he has. That is why I asked Jesus to come into my heart. I want you to know that how you handle yourself in the fire, in the crisis, will draw people to Christ. How you handle crisis in your life will make people follow you to the church and to Christ. I would like us to bow our heads in prayer. Thank you, Father, for the courage that you have given them to be able to say, yes, Jesus, come into my heart. I cannot do it alone. Like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they announced their loyalty. No matter what, they were loyal to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.